Moving on, Justice Secretary Crispine Remulla LA's fears the agency tasked to go after the ill-gotten wealth of the family of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. will be abolished. Remulla says he actually wants to expand the mandate of the PCGG. Let's get a reaction on this from former PCGG Commissioner Attorney Ruben Carranza. He now joins us from New York, I believe. Attorney Carranza, good afternoon to you. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
All right. So this is nothing new. We've heard it from then candidate, or I think it was when he was waiting to be proclaimed, Ferdinand Marcos Jr. then saying that he might just expand the role of the PCGG. And now we're hearing it from Justice Secretary Crispine Remulla. I want to get your thoughts about the concept, the idea of the expansion of the role of the PCGG, Attorney Carranza.
Expansion here is just another word for dilution, to dilute the function of the PCGG in specifically going after the family of Ferdinand Marcos, including the president of the Philippines right now, as well as the cronies of the Marcos family. And it's also another way of using the PCGG to go after Marcos cronies who have refused to give up what the Marcos family thinks are their share in ill-gotten assets that, according to the Marcos family, the cronies only hold for them temporarily. So it's a way of, like I said, diluting the functions of the PCGG, as well as a way of going after Marcos cronies.
Mm. You sort of stopped short there by saying that they can actually weaponize the PCGG. Is that your concern as well?
Well, it's my concern, but more than that, it's also using the PCGG itself to defeat the very idea of recovering ill-gotten wealth from the Marcos family.
Mm. Now, because it's being talked about now, but in the future, of course, you mentioned the dilution. That is a very clear concern right there. But what else could be the reverberating effects of the expansion of the PCGG even after the Marcos Jr. administration ends?
The Justice Secretary appointed by Marcos Jr. Himself would know what the reverberations are for Marcos cronies. His family, the Remulla family, in fact, still has a pending case according to the records of the PCGG under Rodrigo Duterte. In their own accomplishment report in 2021, the PCGG under Duterte lists civil case 0062, Republic of the Philippines versus Remulla, as one of the pending cases in the Sandigan Bayan. So many of these cases are still pending before the Sandigan Bayan or in the Supreme Court, as well as in the United States. In the United States alone, there are cases involving the Arelma assets that is still to be returned from the United States to the Philippines. There are cases involving paintings and other ill-gotten wealth that was recovered from the aide of Imelda Marcos named Vilma Bautista, who was already convicted of tax fraud in the United States. There are several cases still pending that need to be enforced in the sense that they've been decided by the Philippine Supreme Court, but the PCGG, the Solicitor General, and perhaps the Department of Justice, under whom the PCGG has been placed in 2007, should enforce them. A good example of this is the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant case decided by the Supreme Court last year, where the Supreme Court said that the cousin of Ferdinand Marcos Jr., the late Herminio Dicini, and therefore now the heirs, the cousins of Ferdinand Marcos Jr., are the ones who owe 1 billion pesos as money obtained by Herminio Dicini through bribery that they now have to return to the Philippines. What will happen to that? He's been quiet about that. He hasn't said anything about it. But these are actually obligations of the Marcos family that still have to be fulfilled.
Yeah, let me digress here a bit and talk about the BNPP. The president, in his latest State of the Nation address, also saying that he wants to re-examine the use of nuclear energy. In another interview, he also mentioned the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant. Can you actually revisit that, re-examine the BNPP without settling the obligations, Attorney Carranza?
Well, that's the equivalent of double jeopardy in both health and corruption, because now you have a nuclear power plant that his father himself stopped the construction of, not only because of the corruption committed by their family member, Herminio Dicini, but also because Marcos dictatorship scientists themselves found that the nuclear power plant is unsafe. So he wants to revive an unsafe nuclear power plant, and then he ignores the fact that his family, his cousins, are still obligated to pay back 1 billion pesos to the Filipino people from the bribery that his family committed involving the nuclear power plant. But it's not just the nuclear power plant, Carmina. In 2003, when the Philippine Supreme Court said that the Marcos spouses hid stolen money, money stolen from the Filipino people, hid them in Switzerland, and those are the words of the Philippine Supreme Court, we did recover $680 million from the Swiss bank accounts. But this ruling doesn't only involve those Swiss bank accounts. It involves all the other assets still hidden by the Marcos family. In other words, this ruling can be enforced against all assets of the Marcoses. So the Justice Secretary of Ferdinand Marcos is wrong in saying that there are, I read a quotation from him. He said, the assets being to be recovered are dwindling. The assets to be recovered are not dwindling. They're hidden. How would he know that they're dwindling if he does not want to look for them?
Mm. So going back to the recovery of the Marcos ill-gotten wealth, I mean, here we are, we're talking about the PCGG possibly expanding its role to go after other corrupt officials. But even beyond, or even before that expansion, can the PCGG actually perform its original mandate under the presidency of Marcos Jr., Attorney Carranza?
Well, the PCGG has a technically a good recovery rate, given its budget over time and given the amount of money it has recovered, 174 billion pesos, with 125 billion pesos more in assets still to be recovered, it has been able to perform, notwithstanding the institutional weakness, notwithstanding the political obstacles in place, notwithstanding the corruption that has been committed undoubtedly by some officials of the commission itself. The commission has served its purpose and is still serving its purpose. When the Justice Secretary says he will expand and he will use the PCGG's institutional capacity to preserve forfeited assets, apply this knowledge and capacity to other crimes, to drug trafficking, to smuggling, I think these measures are measures that he should perhaps recommend be legislated separately through the agencies that are meant to go after drug traffickers. Instead of extrajudicial killings, perhaps the Philippine government should actually go after high-level drug lords, engage in high-level trafficking, and forfeit their assets. The same with smuggling, the same with other corrupt officials. But the PCGG was created for a purpose. In fact, under the Philippine Constitution, Article 11, Section 15, and this is to refute the Justice Secretary's, again, quotation that we cannot go after the Marcos family's assets for 100 years. Nobody is saying that it will take 100 years. It took us a few years, in fact, to litigate and recover $680 million from Switzerland. But under the Constitution, in fact, says that there is no deadline to recover ill-gotten wealth from public officials. So even Marcos Jr.'s sons, grandsons, if he ever has grandsons or granddaughters in the future, they will still be liable to return ill-gotten wealth stolen by their grandparents.
And we're going to have to leave it at that. Attorney Ruben Carranza right there, former PCGG commissioner, thank you for joining us this afternoon. Really appreciate it. Take care and you keep safe.
Thank you.